From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
When it comes to high-value targeting, every mission is to go after one person at a time. But anybody else that's killed in that strike is just blanketly assumed to be an associate of the targeted individual.
A U.S. drone war whistleblower has been arrested and charged with violating the Espionage Act. We'll hear from former Air Force Airman Daniel Hale in his own words and speak to the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist James Risen, director of First Look Media's Press Freedom Defense Fund. Daniel Hale is at least the sixth alleged journalistic source charged by the Trump administration over the past 2 years. Then, as a nation prepares to celebrate Mother's Day, we look at Black Mama's Bailout Day.
Have set out with a vision and an intention to bail out as many Black mamas as possible. We know that about 80% of Black women that are sitting in cages right now are single parents and caretakers.
And we look at the turmoil within the National Rifle Association following the ouster of former Iran-Contra figure Oliver North as the group's president.
The National Rifle Association is deeply troubled, and it's telling people that it's deeply troubled because of overzealous prosecutors, regulators, and Democrats. It's saying that we're in financial peril because we're being attacked from out the outside, when in actuality, the NRA's real problems are from within.
Is the NRA imploding as mass shootings continue around the country? All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Trump administration's imposed tariffs of 25% on over $200 billion of Chinese goods, even as trade talks between the U.S. and China continue in Washington, D.C. The new tougher tariffs went into effect just after midnight Eastern time today, prompting Chinese trade officials to promise immediate countermeasures against U.S. exports. At the White House, President Trump claimed China undermined recent trade talks by seeking a renegotiation.
I did get last night a very beautiful letter from President Xi. Let's work together. Let's see if we can get something done. But they renegotiated the deal. I mean, they took, whether it's intellectual property theft, they took many, many parts of that deal and they renegotiated. You can't do that.
Trump says he's preparing to order tariffs on virtually all Chinese imports, some $540 billion worth of products brought into the U.S. each year. Talks between the U.S. trade officials and their Chinese counterparts are set to continue today in Washington. President Trump's nominated Patrick Shanahan to become the next Secretary of Defense. Shanahan has been acting Pentagon chief since Trump fired James Mattis at the start of the year. Last month, an internal Pentagon ethics investigation cleared Shanahan following accusations he unfairly favored the weapons contractor Boeing, where he spent over three decades as an executive. A former U.S. intelligence analyst was arrested Thursday and charged with violating the Espionage Act for allegedly leaking documents about the secretive U.S. drone program. 31-year-old Daniel Hale was arrested in Nashville, Tennessee. He faces up to 50 years in prison. Hale was enlisted in the Air Force from 2009 to 2013, during which he worked with the National Security Agency and the Joint Special Operations Task Force at the Bagram Air Base in Afghanistan, where he helped identify targets for assassination. He later worked as a contractor for the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. Hale is accused of disclosing 11 top-secret or secret documents to a reporter. The indictment does not name the reporter, but unnamed government sources have told media outlets the reporter is investigative journalist Jeremy Scahill of The Intercept. After headlines, we'll go to Maryland to speak with The Intercept's senior national security correspondent, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist James Risen. In Northern Virginia, famed U.S. Army whistleblower Chelsea Manning was released from a federal prison Thursday after spending 62 days behind bars for refusing to testify to a grand jury. Manning had been subpoenaed to answer questions about her leak of hundreds of thousands of secret State Department and Pentagon documents to WikiLeaks, including evidence of U.S. war crimes. The grand jury ultimately disbanded. Manning's freedom could be short-lived, her lawyer said in a statement she will again refuse to testify in response to a separate subpoena. In northwestern Syria, dozens of people have been reported killed amidst heavy airstrikes by Russian and Syrian warplanes. Among the dead are the parents and siblings of 2-year-old Khadija Ahamdan, who is the sole survivor of an airstrike that flattened her home in Idlib province. The UK-based Syrian Observatory for Human Rights says Syrian forces have dropped over a dozen barrel bombs in recent days on Idlib, backed by scores of Russian airstrikes which have hit schools and hospitals. The United Nations has called for an urgent de-escalation of fighting. In Iraq, the Islamic State claimed responsibility for a bombing in Baghdad's Sadr City district Thursday that it says killed 8 people and wounded more than 10 others. The attack came just 2 days after Secretary of State Mike Pompeo made a surprise visit to Baghdad to discuss Iran's presence in Iraq. In northern France, human rights activists are attempting to block authorities from loading French weapons onto a Saudi vessel, saying the shipment would be used to kill civilians in Yemen in violation of an international arms treaty. About 100 protesters turned out Thursday at the port of Le Havre ahead of the arrival of the Saudi ship as lawyers for 2 separate human rights groups sued to prevent the shipment. The protests came after a French news site reported French-made tanks and laser-guided missile systems were being used by the Saudi-led coalition against civilians in Yemen's war. This is Jean-Paul Lecoq, a member of the French National Assembly, who joined Thursday's protest.
The war in Yemen is a difficult war. We are turned into supporters of Saudi Arabia, and if we, the French citizens, do not act, if we don't try to stop arms sales, we will end up as accessories to this business. We don't want this. We don't want to be in this situation. The French president shouldn't be allowed to decide on his own if France can sell or not sell weapons. This decision should belong to European democracies and Parliament.
The Trump administration said Thursday it seized a North Korean cargo vessel that was being used to transport coal in violation of U.S. and United Nations sanctions. The ship was first seized by Indonesia over a year ago. It's now being moved to U.S. territory in American Samoa. The announced seizure of the ship came just after North Korea test-fired a pair of short-range missiles amidst a breakdown in denuclearization talks with the U.S. In Washington, D.C., authorities cut off water and electricity to Venezuela's embassy as activists with Code Pink and other organizations continue around-the-clock occupation in order to prevent a takeover of the building by Venezuela's U.S.-backed opposition. The activists entered the embassy in late April at the invitation of Venezuela's government. Opposition groups led by Juan Guaido and backed by the Trump administration have pledged to take over the building. So far, police and Secret Service agents have arrested 9 activists, including Jerry Condon, a 72-year-old Vietnam War veteran, and the president of Veterans for Peace, who was violently tackled and pressed to the pavement Wednesday by 5 officers after he tried to bring food to protesters occupying the embassy. Condon was left bleeding from the head and needed medical treatment. He's been charged with throwing a missile, resisting arrest, and assaulting police officers as he attempted to get food inside the building. Alabama State Senate delayed a vote Thursday on a law that would ban virtually all abortions after a rancorous floor debate that saw lawmakers repeatedly shout in protest. The bill would make providing an abortion a Class A felony punishable by up to 99 years in prison. The Alabama Senate Minority Leader Bobby Singleton objected after Republican leaders sought to remove amendments from the abortion ban that would have allowed exemptions in cases of rape or incest.
He didn't even make a motion, Mr. President.
Hold on.
He made a motion.
He made a motion to table.
He did not make a motion. There was no motion from the other side. No,
he made a motion to table.
Singleton and other Democrats also protested when Republican leaders attempted to pass amendments on a voice vote. They demanded a roll call so that lawmakers' votes would be put on the record. This is Andrea Miller, president of the National Institute of Reproductive Health.
I mean, the reality is what happened in the Alabama Senate just shows how high the stakes are right now when a state is planning to ban all abortions outright and not only eliminate access to abortion care for the people in their state, but in an effort to eliminate it for everyone all across the country, because they hope they'll be the ones to bring the case to the Supreme Court that will overturn or severely eviscerate Roe versus Wade.
In Colorado, the mother of a STEM student at the school Highlands Ranch says she tried to warn school officials last year about the potential for violence at the Denver area high school, but was ignored. The school was the site of a mass shooting Tuesday when a pair of students armed with handguns went on a shooting spree, killing 18-year-old student Kendra Castillo and injuring eight others. CNN reports the mother, who's remaining anonymous, called the school board in December, warning of a crushing academic workload leading to violent sexual assault and bullying on campus. She said, quote, "Those are the elements that we need for the perfect storm, for something like a Columbine or some kind of imminent threat to our children's safety in the school, whether it be a bomb or an active shooter or a suicide," unquote. STEM school officials disputed the claim and even filed a lawsuit against the unnamed mother in January over what they called defamatory statements. And Facebook co-founder Chris Hughes is calling on the federal government to break up the social media giant. Whiting, in a lengthy new New York Times opinion piece published Thursday, Hughes cited past antitrust actions that broke up Standard Oil and AT&T. He wrote, quote, "I'm disappointed in myself and the early Facebook team for not thinking more about how the news feed algorithm could change our culture, influence elections, and empower nationalist leaders. And I'm worried that Mark Zuckerberg has surrounded himself with a team that reinforces his beliefs instead of challenging them," unquote. Hughes' op-ed comes just weeks after Massachusetts Senator and 2020 hopeful Elizabeth Warren unveiled a plan to break up tech giants, including Facebook, Google, and Amazon. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. A former U.S. intelligence analyst was arrested Thursday and charged with violating the Espionage Act for allegedly leaking documents about the secretive U.S. drone program. 31-year-old Daniel Hale was arrested in Nashville, Tennessee. He faces up to 50 years in prison. Hale was enlisted in the Air Force from 2009 to 2013, during which he worked with the National Security Agency and the Joint Special Operations Task Force at the Bagram Air Base in Afghanistan, where he helped identify targets to be assassinated. He later worked as a contractor for the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. Hale's accused of disclosing 11 top-secret or secret documents to a reporter. The indictment does not name the reporter, but unnamed government sources have told media outlets the reporter is investigative journalist Jeremy Scahill of The Intercept. In 2015, The Intercept published a special report called The Drone Papers, exposing the inner workings of the U.S. military's assassination program in Afghanistan, Yemen, and Somalia. The publication's findings were later turned into a book called The Assassination Complex, Inside the Government's Secret Drone Warfare Program. In a statement, The Intercept's editor-in-chief, Betsy Reid, said, quote, "The Intercept does not comment on matters relating to the identity of anonymous sources. In an indictment unsealed on May 9th, the government alleges documents on the U.S. drone program were leaked to a news organization. These documents detailed a secret, unaccountable process for targeting and killing people around the world, including U.S. citizens, through drone strikes. They are of vital public importance, and activity related to their disclosure is protected by the First Amendment." Reid went on to say, quote, "The alleged whistleblower faces up to 50 years in prison. No one has ever been held accountable for killing civilians in drone strikes," she said. After leaving the Air Force in 2013, Daniel Hale began publicly speaking out against the drone program. In November 2013, he spoke at a drone summit in Washington, D.C., organized by Code Pink.
Before I begin, one last thing. I just would like to, in a way, say I'm sorry. I'm not up here for any good reasons. And to the people in the audience who are victims or who are families of victims or have families who live in countries where U.S. militarism and specifically unmanned systems are conducting kinetic strikes. I'm sorry because I'm up here because I was for a time, a short period of time during my military career, as a an analyst working with unmanned systems deployed to Afghanistan. And at the very least, you all deserve an apology.
In January 2014, Daniel Hale spoke at a rally outside the White House calling for the closing of the U.S. military prison at Guantanamo.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Daniel Hale. I was a veteran of the United States Air Force from 2009 until 2013. Through my experience and my deployment to Afghanistan, where I was primarily tasked with pursuing high-value targets through the utilization of unmanned systems, or otherwise known as drones, I came to learn of the thousands of prisoners who remain at the prison in Bagram Air Force Base to this day who are in similar situations to those at Guantanamo, who are continually held indefinitely for benign or otherwise petty offenses or reasons not given to them whatsoever.
Daniel Hale was also featured in the documentary National Bird about drone warfare whistleblowers. It was directed by Sonia Kennebec.
The people who defend drones and defend the way that they're used, they always say, you know, they protect American lives by not putting them in harm's way. But what they really do is they just embolden commanders. They embolden decision makers because there is no threat. There is no immediate consequence. They can do this strike and they can potentially kill this person that they're so desperate to get and to eliminate because of how dangerous, potentially dangerous, they could be to the U.S. But if it just so happens that they don't kill that person or that some other people are involved in the strike and get killed as well, you know, there's no consequence for it. When it comes to high-value targeting, every mission is to go after one person at a time. But anybody else that's killed in that strike is just blanketly assumed to be an associate of the targeted individual. So as long as they can reasonably identify that all of the people in the field of view of the camera are military-aged males, meaning anybody who's believed to be of age 16 or older, they are a legitimate target under the rules of engagement. If the strike occurs and kills all of them, they just say that they got them all.
Drone whistleblower Daniel Hale speaking in the documentary National Bird. In August 2014, the FBI raided Hale's house, but the Obama Justice Department never filed charges. In the film, Hale spoke about the possibility of being indicted.
Personally, like, I just live every day trying to become more and more comfortable with the idea that it's probably going to happen, that I'm probably going to get indicted and I'm probably going to get charged with a crime, and that there's probably a real chance that I'll have to fight to stay out of prison.
Those are the words of drone whistleblower Daniel Hale, who was arrested in Nashville on Thursday. After appearing in court, he was released under pretrial supervision. His next court hearing is May 17th. According to the Freedom of the Press Foundation, Hale is at least the sixth alleged journalistic source charged by the Trump administration over the past 2 years. We're now joined by the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist James Risen. He's a former New York Times reporter who's now The Intercept's senior national security correspondent. He's also director of First Look Media's Press Freedom Defense Fund. First Look is the parent company of The Intercept. Risen himself was involved in a high-profile press freedom case involving former CIA officer Jeffrey Sterling, who was jailed after being convicted under the Espionage Act for speaking with Risen. James Risen, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. First, can you respond to the arrest of Daniel Hale?
Well, I think I can't comment specifically on this case, but what I can say is that this is a yet another escalation of the war on the press by the Trump administration. Donald Trump has taken the war on the press that George Bush and Barack Obama started and has now escalated beyond anything we've ever seen. And the Justice Department under Trump has been so thoroughly politicized that they are going after every possible whistleblower and reporter and any kind of leak that they can find in order to silence the press and silence whistleblowers who are trying to reveal the truth about both the national security state and other aspects of the Trump administration.
Hmm. Now, can you explain why it is you think he was arrested now? What they are alleging happened something like 5 years ago under the Obama Justice Department, which decided not to charge Daniel Hale.
That's why I'm saying I think this is part of Trump's escalation of the war on the press beyond anything we've seen before. They're going back over every possible leak they can find, over every old open case, and trying to escalate things beyond what Obama did. You know, I think you saw that with the Julian Assange case, where, you know, the Obama administration had investigated him for years and never taken the final step of indicting him. And, you know, then the Trump administration did so. So I think you're seeing that, you know, the Justice Department, which has been under such enormous pressure from Trump on a wide range of issues, particularly the Russia investigation, where he has constantly been pressuring one attorney general after the other. I think that the Justice Department finds it much easier to give in to him on leak investigations than on other things. They're happy to go after journalists and their sources, and so they're satisfying Trump's demand to punish the press for what he doesn't like bad press. He gets a lot of bad press, and so he's going after he's trying to punish the press in the ways that he knows he can.
You know that Daniel Hale faces up to 50 years in prison. While no one has been held accountable for the killing of civilians in drone strikes, let's specifically talk about what Daniel Hale is accused of revealing, what his time in Afghanistan was all about, the significance of his revelations.
I think one of the things we have to understand is that there's been virtually no debate in the United States over the drone program, over the assassination programs that the United States has engaged in both in Afghanistan and Iraq and elsewhere since the war on terror began. And one of the only things that the only ways we understand what has happened is through the press and through disclosures from people in the government who have told us what the secret programs are like. If it wasn't for people like Daniel Hale, whistleblowers who came forward, you would have virtually no understanding of the entire war on terror, and in particular, the drone strike program. It's only through disclosures in the press that we have understood what's happening, and that's the only reason we've had any debate at all. People in Congress have been very reluctant to engage in any kind of discussion of classified information until it's in the press. And so most of the oversight that you see on these programs only comes because there have been disclosures in the press that, you know, people have stepped forward with some courage to explain what's happened. You know, if you look back, at the beginning, the entire war on terror was classified. And it's only through a lot of different disclosures in the press that we understand what the war on terror has really been about.
I wanted to turn to Intercept co-founder, your colleague, Jeremy Scahill. Speaking about the drone papers, not now, the investigation that The Intercept did. And again, Jeremy Scahill was not named in the indictment. But this is Jeremy speaking about the drone papers on Democracy Now! In 2015.
What we've published is an extensive look into how this program has operated historically, but specifically under President Obama. One of the most significant findings of this, and my colleague Cora Currier really dug deep into this, is we published for the first time the kill chain, what the bureaucracy of assassination looks like. And what you see is that all of these officials, including people like the Treasury Secretary, are part of signing off on all of this. where they have these secret meetings, and they discuss who's going to live and die around the world. And at the end of that process, it is the president of the United States who signs what amounts to a death warrant for whoever they've decided should die based on what amounts to a parallel secret judicial system in the United States that is not really subjected to any kind of judicial review, where the president acts sort of as emperor, issues an edict that you die. And what we show, and this is the first time that there's documentary evidence of this, is that the president gives the military a 60-day window to hunt down and kill these individuals. Ken Roth from Human Rights Watch pointed out today, if the standard is that the people who are being targeted for assassination is that they represent an imminent threat, which is what the president says the U.S. policy is, then why do they have 60 days to do it? Why don't they need to do it now if it's imminent? Well, that's because they've redefined the term imminent to be so vague as to not even resemble its actual commonly understood definition.
During his 2015 interview on Democracy Now!, I asked journalist Jeremy Scahill about his sources for the drone papers expose.
This is a very brave whistleblower, and this administration has been relentless in its war against whistleblowers. And, you know, I mean, Chelsea Manning is rotting right now in a prison cell for exposing U.S. war crimes. Edward Snowden is in exile. Thomas Drake and Bill Binney, you know, were smeared in public and had their reputations ruined. Jeffrey Sterling is in prison right now. You know, this, our source is an incredibly principled, brave individual. And, you know, I worry because the government is, this government has been relentless in its pursuit of people of conscience who blow the whistle and has characterized them as traitors and spies, and in the process has criminalized the ability to do independent journalism that is meant to hold them accountable, the government accountable, without fear that your sources, or in some cases the journalists themselves, are going to be put in the crosshairs of the so-called justice system.
So that's Jeremy Scahill speaking in 2015 when the whole drone expose, drone war expose, was printed in The Intercept. Now, again, the Justice Department does not name the interceptor Jeremy Scahill in the 17-page indictment, but media outlets have quoted senior Trump administration officials saying it's Jeremy Scahill and The Intercept. It's also interesting that Jeremy references Chelsea Manning being in jail. That was then, in 2015. She was sent back to jail. She just came out yesterday after 62 days after a grand jury disbanded and she couldn't be held any longer. But, James Risen, if you can talk about the emphasis that media outlets around this country are putting on who was Daniel Hale, who did he leak the documents to, as opposed to the content of what he was leaking, and what you're saying at The Intercept.
Right. I think one of the things that for many years has really bothered me is the way the media, the mainstream media, covers leak investigation stories. They cover it as if there's a hunt for a criminal, rather than a story about whistleblowers coming forward with to perform a public service. And that's always bothered me in the way the press covers these things. It's as if they're joining in with the Justice Department and the prosecutor in hunting down a bank robber or something. And so I think that's a fundamental flaw in the way the press covers these things, is that they look at it as a crime rather than as an attack by the Justice Department on the press in the United States, which is what this is. This is yet another attempt by Trump, following up on the Obama and the Bush administrations to do similar things, to silence the press and to silence whistleblowers on a very important issue, which is how does the United States go about deciding who lives and dies around the world? I mean, it's a frightening power that we in the United States have somehow, by default, given to the president and to the CIA and the Air Force. And it's very scary to me that so few people, both in the media and in the general public, have been willing to engage in a real significant debate about this fundamental issue of who lives and dies. And I think part of it is that the drone program allows the United States to do this with very low casualty rates and to engage in wars around the world by remote control. And that has, we have allowed that to continue because it's very convenient and easy for Americans to forget that it's happening. And I think the drone papers project by The Intercept was a major public service to expose the way in which this occurs.
Danielle Hale becomes the third person charged with allegedly leaking information to The Intercept. The others are former Air Force linguist Reality Winner and former FBI agent Terry Albury, who leaked classified information about how the FBI aggressively targets potential informants. Now, interestingly, the indictment does not name The Intercept or Jeremy Scahill, which suggests they don't actually have the evidence there. But, of course, the Trump administration is leaking their names. Do you think they are trying to target, to take down The Intercept by making it an unsafe place for whistleblowers to turn to?
I don't know about that, and I can't comment specifically, as I said, on this case. But what I can say is that The Intercept has continued to do very aggressive national security reporting throughout this the last few years, and it's continuing to do so now. And we're still working on major, very aggressive, very sensitive national security projects that hopefully will appear in the future. And I think if anybody thinks that it's possible to silence us, then they don't know anything about us.
What is the significance of Hale being charged under the Espionage Act specifically?
The Espionage Act has been used both by this administration and by the Obama administrations. It's a very crude weapon from the World War I era in which the government is able to take this very vague law that was designed for red baiting after World War I, and then for the McCarthy era of conducting communist era investigations, and they've turned it instead of using it against spies, they now use it against people who talk to the press. And so, what basically the message that they're sending is that talking to a reporter is the same as being a spy, which is a ridiculous abuse of the legal system. And it's something that I feel very strongly about that has to change in this country if we're going to maintain an independent press. Because the way in which the Espionage Act is used is it's a very crude weapon to try to silence people.
I mean, the New York Times, the Washington Post have been hailed as heroes, for example, when it came to the Pentagon Papers, Daniel Ellsberg. It wasn't, how dare these papers do this. It's that these papers dared to defy those they hold in accountable and those in power. At the time, it was Richard Nixon. Can you talk about the difference then and also briefly tell us what happened to you? This wasn't during the Trump years. This was what happened to you during the Obama years, and this wasn't when you were at The Intercept, but at The New York Times.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I was was subpoenaed by the Justice Department for a grand jury subpoena that several times, and I refused to testify in a leak investigation involving stories I did on Iran and the CIA. And finally, I was subpoenaed to go to both the grand jury and then a trial, and I fought those for 7 years and appealed it to the Supreme Court, and I lost ultimately. But I decided to continue to fight it, even though we had lost in the courts. And in 2015, the government finally backed down and decided not to put me in jail for not testifying. The that led me, that experience, which lasted 7 or 8 years, led me to feel very strongly that we have to have some organizations in this country that protect journalists and their sources, and we have to have more aggressive news organizations that continue to investigate the national security state in ways that some news organizations are no longer willing to or are reluctant to do. And that's one reason I'm very proud of The Intercept. I think we have continued very aggressive investigative reporting in the face of a lot of obstacles and at a time when a lot of other news organizations are not doing so.
Jim Risen, do you think that the other news organizations are hanging The Intercept out to dry? Do you feel you're getting enough support from other news organizations?
Well, you know, to me, that doesn't matter. Frankly, I don't care what other people say about me or about The Intercept. I think we're just going to keep trying to do our jobs. And I think we should let our work speak for itself. And I think that's what I'm going to try to do. And in the future, people can try to match our stories.
Let's end with the words of drone whistleblower and former Air Force intelligence analyst Daniel Hale himself, speaking in the 2016 documentary National Bird, directed by Sonia Kennebec.
When the president gets up in front of the nation and says that they're doing everything they can to ensure that there is near certainty that there will be no civilians killed, he is saying that because he can't say otherwise. Because any time an action is taken to finish a target, there is a certain amount of guesswork in that action. Because it's only in the aftermath of any kind of ordnance being dropped that you know just how much actual damage was done. And oftentimes, the intelligence community is reliant, the Joint Special Operations Command, the CIA included, is reliant on intelligence coming afterwards that confirms that who they were targeting was killed in that strike or that they weren't killed in that strike.
Again, that is Daniel Hale. This was from 2016, before what happened yesterday. The former U.S. intelligence analyst arrested Thursday and charged with violating the Espionage Act for allegedly leaking documents about the secretive U.S. drone program. He was arrested in Nashville, faces up to 50 years in prison. The film came out in 2016. This is Democracy Now! When we come back this weekend, it's National Black Mamas Bailout Day. We'll go to Atlanta, find the latest. Stay with us.
Sola voy con mi pena, sola va mi condena. Correr es mi destino para burlar la ley. Perdida en el corazón de la grande Babilón. Me dicen clandestina por no la quiebra ley.
Lila Downs performing here in our Democracy Now! Studios, a cover of the Manu Chao classic Clandestino. Visit democracynow.org to see her full performance and interview. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. It's Mother's Day this weekend. Racial justice groups around the country are bailing out black women out of jail so they can spend the holiday with their families. For the third year in a row, Black Mama's Bailout Day is raising money to bail out as many black women from jail as possible. The effort's taking place in dozens of cities to call attention to the injustice of cash bail. On Thursday afternoon, two organizers, Kyla Hartsfield and Serena Sebring, chained themselves to a gate at the Durham County Jail to protest cash bail policies. One of their supporters, Grace Nichols, spoke to local station WNCN.
Folks are stuck in jails because they can't afford to get out, not because they've actually been convicted of a crime. So we would like to bring attention to this ransom and show folks that it is unjust.
That was North Carolina. The National Bailout Collective has helped post bail for more than 300 individuals across the country. Since Black Mama's Bailout Day launched, there's been a growing national movement to eliminate cash bail from the criminal justice system. For more, we're going to Atlanta, Georgia, where we're joined once again by Mary Hooks, the co-director of Southerners on New Ground, or SONG, which is part of the National Bailout Collective and the movement for Black Lives. Mary Hooks, welcome back to Democracy Now! Talk about Mother's Day and what you're doing.
Hi, friend. So we're excited to kick off our third annual Black Mother's Day bailout to continue to highlight the crisis of what's happening to Black women who are stuffed in cages because they don't have money to pay their bail. We see that this growing movement is an indication that so many people want to see changes happen as it relates to pretrial detention. And this this opportunity to bail out people and to collectivize our resources in order to do it is also an indication that many people are seeing that the solutions to the issues that are happening in our community actually lie within our communities. We've been able to do so much over the last 2 years together through the National Bailout Collective and several organizations who have built political alignment around what we mean when we say we want to end cash bail and pretrial detention. So we want to see a needs-based approach to ending cash bail and to make sure that people can get back to court. And it continues to floor me, the ways in which people continue to show up for this initiative. We're looking to change policy, but we're also looking to change hearts and minds as we continue to move through this process of bailing mothers out and continuing to build the infrastructure we need in our communities to get our people out of cages and support our people as they go through the court system.
You've certainly kicked off a national movement. Reality television star Kim Kardashian West has reportedly helped release 17 people from prison in the last 3 months as part of a 90 Days of Freedom campaign. Kardashian West quietly helped fund a team of female attorneys working to free first-time nonviolent drug offenders. She's also reportedly studying 18 hours a week to take the bar exam and become a lawyer herself. Talk about the significance of this. And, of course, Kim Kardashian has the ear of President Trump, was in the White House.
Well, you know, I think, as you stated, Kim Kardashian has quietly done this. And it's the media, however, that continues to draw attention to her efforts. But I want to take the time to shout out Ms. Cody and Ms. Barnett, who has been doing this work for years. And those are the two Black women lawyers who have, you know, put a lot of sweat in the game in order to continue to free folk from cages. And so shout out to Kim for continuing to cash in her white privilege to do what must be done for the sake of other folks' liberation. And, you know, efforts like that should continue to happen. And we should see other entertainers and celebrities get up under grassroots movements and the work that's being led by Black women, queer and trans people to free our people.
Mm. Talk about what happened in Durham, North Carolina.
So Durham was engaged in a Mother's Day bailout as well. And as we continue to bail our people out, because we, again, must do what we have to do, what must be done, we oftentimes see local policymakers, judges, et cetera, who continue to shell out small solutions to a very big problem. In Durham right now, there are judges who want to implement risk assessment, want to continue to use bail schedules. None of those things benefit our communities. And so part of our work is to agitate and escalate the crisis. And so what my two comrades did yesterday and chained themselves to the gates of the jail was to say, not today, not today, that these attacks are happening daily on our communities. And if we can intervene and interrupt that violence that's taking place, then that's what we're going to do. And so, you know, the brave comrades there and all of those allies who did a sit-in inside of the jail, folks took to the street and shut down the street. Like, yes, we want to bail out Black mothers and continue to show love in that way. And we also show our love through the resistance that we bring to the streets and we bring to this issue to continue to push policymakers locally, statewide, nationally, to continue to listen to what we have to say and really take heed to the solutions and the community-based solutions and call, as we call for, a divestment from the courts, cops, and cages, and an investment in community-based resources and community-based support for our people.
The family of Sandra Bland is calling for authorities to reopen its investigation into her death. The 28-year-old African-American woman died in a Texas jail cell in 2015, 3 days after she was arrested for allegedly failing to signal a lane change. Authorities have claimed Sandra Bland took her own life while in jail by hanging herself with a garbage bag. But her family's long rejected this claim. On Monday, the Dallas TV station WFAA aired cell phone video filmed by Sandra Bland herself, capturing the moment when she was pulled over. In the 39-second video, you can see the officer, Brian Encinia, drawing his stun gun and saying, "I will light you up.
Get out of the car, now."
Why am I being apprehended? You trying to give me a ticket for your failure?
Get out of the car.
Why am I being apprehended? You just opened my car door. You just opened my car door. So you're threatening to drag me out of my own car?
Get out of the car.
And then you're going to stun me?
I will light you up. Get out.
Wow.
Now.
Wow.
Get out of the car.
Really, for a failure to signal. You're doing all of this for
get
a failure to signal.
Get over there.
Right, yeah. Yeah, let's take this to court. Let's do
go
it.
Ahead.
For a failure to signal. Yep, for a failure to signal.
Get off the phone.
On my school.
Get off the phone.
I'm not on the phone. I have a right
put
to record. This is
down.
My property. This
put
is
your
my
phone
property.
Down.
Sir?
Put your phone down. Right now.
Attorneys for the Bland family say the cell phone video proves the officer lied when he had claimed he felt his safety was in jeopardy when he pulled over Sandra Bland. Now, she was then put in jail. She couldn't afford the $500 bail. I think it was like $5,000 bond in jail for 3 days. And then they say she took her own life, which her family disputes. Mary Hooks.
This is unacceptable. And the same ways in which our people do not and have every right to distrust the police, that same level of distrust is also for the court system. And I know in my soul that every DA, prosecutor, and anybody else who put their hands on this case and investigated this case, they knew about the cell phone video. They knew that she was not a threat. They knew that his life was not in danger. And they manipulated the laws and rules on his behalf in order for him to get a sweet deal and eventually get his charges dismissed. I believe that he eventually signed a letter saying, "I would never work in law enforcement again." And this is unacceptable. And so, in as much as we are in a time where people think that we are moving, bending the arc as it relates to police and their relationship to Black communities, let us not be fooled. We have no reason to trust the police or the cops or the courts, and we have to make sure that we take care of ourselves and that we support and take care of our own people, and that until further notice, we should continue to make sure we demand justice for people who are stuck in cages because they cannot afford bail, because their lives are at stake. And we oftentimes see, you know, for folks who are sitting in cages, the decimation of their health, whether that's, you know, through the killing by guards. That's the abuse that is happening. Right now, I'm sitting in Fulton County, and we have a jail here called Union City, and there is a lawsuit that has been filed against them because women are showering in black mold. Their throats are swollen. They have masks over their face. They're being abused in so many ways. Those who experience mental health are literally stuffed in a cage and never come out, and are never come out. And so this breaks my heart as someone who has been in that situation before. I've had my face beaten by the police before. And so I think we have to continue to dispel that myth that though police provide some level of public safety is when our people have adequate housing, adequate jobs that are dignified, that people can thrive and have wellness. That is how we get public safety. And anything else is a lie. And so I send my condolences to Sandra Bland's family and all the people who have lost their loved ones to heinous police violence and corrections officers' violence, and all those who have participated in situations like this where we know that justice have not been served. And the real reality of it is we know that can never be found in this criminal injustice system.
Well, Mary Hooks, I want to thank you so much for being with us, co-director of Southerners on New Ground, or SONG, which is is part of the National Bailout Collective and the Movement for Black Lives. She's an organizer of National Black Mamas Bailout Day, which is Mother's Day on Sunday. This is Democracy Now. When we come back, the NRA in turmoil. Stay with us. The acclaimed Mexican singer Lila Downs performing here in our Democracy Now! Studio. Check out her interview and music at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. Is the National Rifle Association imploding? As the nation grieves over another deadly mass school shooting, we turn to look at how internal turmoil inside the NRA threatens the future of the gun lobbying group. A major new report published by The Trace in partnership with The New Yorker magazine finds that while the NRA has blamed its recent financial woes on left-wing attacks on the Second Amendment, the real damage to the organization comes from within. Reporter Michael Spies writes, quote, "A small group of NRA executives, contractors and vendors has extracted hundreds of millions of dollars from the nonprofit's budget through gratuitous payments, sweetheart deals and opaque financial arrangements. Chief among the NRA's problems is its three-decade-old relationship with Oklahoma-based public relations firm Ackerman McQueen. The firm, which is behind the NRA's imaging, messaging and most of its initiatives, was paid more than $40 million in 2017. The report comes as Iran-Contra figure Oliver North was recently ousted as NRA president after he threatened to reveal evidence of corruption against longtime chief executive Wayne LaPierre. This all comes as New York's Attorney General Letitia James has opened an investigation into the NRA's tax-exempt status. Well, for more, we're joined by Mike Spies, staff writer for The Trace. Welcome to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. You've done incredible work. Explain what happened over these last few weeks. I mean, you have this mass shooting after mass shooting from the University of North Carolina. You've got the San Diego synagogue shooting. And then you have, right near Columbine, another high school shooting. All of this happening as the NRA—well, what happened to Oliver North in this showdown with Wayne LaPierre?
Well, interestingly, you mentioned the NRA's longtime PR firm, Ackerman McQueen, as being the sort of largest or most significant illustration of a larger institutional problem. So Oliver North came to be president of the NRA about a year ago. He also separately held a contract with Ackerman McQueen, the PR firm that you were just mentioning, for some $1 million a year, which posed some kind of conflict of interest. Still, despite that, Oliver North tried to, I think, honestly, take the high road and was concerned about larger institutional issues at the organization that go beyond that firm. And he wanted Wayne LaPierre, who is, I think, very much part of that institutional problem, to address those issues and was pushing him to do so. The response was, of course, to file a lawsuit against Ackerman McQueen, the NRA's longtime PR firm, that largely targeted Oliver North, putting him in sort of an impossible position and effectively forcing him to resign his post as president of the NRA. The sort of really shocking development. It's hard to, like, overstate how crazy this is. That firm created the modern National Rifle Association, as you know it. I mean, whatever the case may be, whatever issues have been going on with, you know, gratuitous payments, vague billings, again, issues that are not just specific to that firm, but a wide variety of contractors and people connected to senior management, that firm made Wayne LaPierre. And Wayne LaPierre is effectively saying right now, the wool was being pulled over my eyes. I didn't know. I didn't know that this was happening. I didn't know Oliver North was had this contract. I didn't understand the business arrangements that were playing out for the last few decades. And that just defies credulity in every possible way.
Well, explain more what you've uncovered about the NRA's financial dealings and corruption. So you've got Oliver North mm-hmm. accusing Wayne LaPierre of gross corruption mm-hmm. and vice versa.
Right. I mean, to be clear, nobody's—I mean, for lack of a better phrase, no one's hands are really clean right now. So it just—we have this sort of—I've used this reference before, but you've got this Game of Thrones scenario where just everyone's trying to fight for their own survival and be the one who comes out victorious sitting on the throne. But what I found came from internal documents, a variety of different public filings, stuff that it's really hard to find in state charity bureaus that involves, like, vendor contracts, that sort of thing. And what I found was there was an atmosphere that was pervaded by secrecy, greed, self-dealing, and you have a number of longstanding vendor arrangements where the NRA is paying lots of money, as you said, hundreds of millions of dollars for contractors that have some kind of special connection to senior management in the organization. Often senior management is not often. I mean, there are people in senior management who are getting paid multiple ways, not just through the NRA itself. They have their own conflicts of interest. They're also handing out contracts at times to their dads or their ex-girlfriends, or they have some connect, or their firm hires their significant other. I mean, there's a whole.
Why did the NRA spend so much money on the 2016 election?
I mean, that question, there seems to not be a very satisfactory answer to that question, in part because they did not have, I mean, the money they spent, they did not have to spend. I mean, I can only speculate. And to be clear, that amount of money came to more than $50 million. And that's coming from an organization that was already in financial trouble. And most of that went toward the election of Donald Trump. I think it was a play. I think the thought was, there's no way Donald Trump's going to win. Every other outside conservative group has essentially said, we're staying out of this race. We're not going to back Donald Trump. Donald Trump was polling very well among the NRA's core members. And I think the thought was, he's going to lose, and then we'll be able to fundraise off of that.
So are we right now talking about, you know, the curtain being pulled back and seeing the Wizard of Oz? You have one mass shooting after another. Politician after politician will say that they themselves and the others are being captured by the NRA and not taking it on. You do have the Democratic candidates running for the 2020 presidential race, one after another, saying, we do have to take this power on. But is there a power there?
Yeah, this is the most important question that anyone can ask. And yes, the curtain has been pulled back. I think for a very long time, perhaps because it's been convenient for some lawmakers to toe this line in order to create a wedge issue, the organization's power is largely mythological. And the myth has worked very well for them. It obviously has intimidated lawmakers, especially at the state level. It's been a really useful tool. But is it real? Or do they have any more power than anybody else? I think that the answer is actually no. It's just the idea of whether or not you're willing to challenge it. But Republicans here's a perfect example. Rick Scott right now, somebody who is governor of Florida, literally did everything the NRA wanted. I mean, there was never a time that he was not carrying
20 the seconds.
Yes. So now all of a sudden he finally, at the end of his term, does not do what the NRA wants. And he still gets elected to the U.S. Senate anyway.
We're going to continue this discussion. We're going to post it as a post-show. Mike Spies, staff writer at The Trace, contributor to The New Yorker. His major expose of the NRA's finances is headline, Secrecy, Self-Dealing, and Greed at the NRA. We will link to it. That does it for our show. Democracy Now! Is currently accepting applications for paid six-month internships here in our New York TV studio. Learn more at democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Produced by Mike Burtina, Gesdner, Nermeen Shea, Carla Wills, Tammy Warnoff, Sam Alkoff, John Hamilton. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.